as it snowed all night in the Engadine. With great fairness, the snow lies equally on trees, lakes, and plains. I like Burden. In the early hours, it is hardly possible to distinguish whole frost and snow. Seen up close, the heaped snow on the trees standing on the slopes appears as thick as the branches and twigs themselves. It speaks for the gentleness with which the snow settles that such an accumulation is possible. High up the valley, on the other hand, close to the ridges and peaks, the clouds have dumped thousands of cubic feet of snow on a small area. But the dirt was swamped to the extent that the walker sinks it up to his neck. Up here, conditions are like those in the icy terrain of the north or in the Hindu Kush in the east. Tom Tiger, who is still considering whether to turn down the commission for a documentary, Who Was Jesus Really?, notes in his workbook that an angel of the Orient and the birthplace of the Savior would be hard to imagine in a snowy setting. Easier to film the snow on the peaks of lofty volcanoes. At the snow line on Mount Etna, the white carpet of new snow borders directly on the black lava zone. That, says Tiger, would be a motif for the beginning of a film. It would have to be called Nature's Paw, because it would be about the tremendous potential slumbering in the Earth's crust. At the moment, I'm working on a translation of Friday Chengel's Dialectic of Nature, from the Russian. Unfortunately, I don't read German. It addresses the vitalization of the tonality of interstellar space. All forms of matter possess a kind of low-level life. Non-conscious life creates the biosphere. And from this thought, lightening the non-sphere emerges. You mean in the year 1080? Put in the diplomat. That's what I assume, replied the Islamist. The acquaintances of so many years sat in wicker chairs, to some extent timelessly or in neutral zone between the times of tempers, in the lobby of one of the grand hotels, which indicates that this meanwhile threatened world terrain was one subject to British rule. These hotel liners are stranded like embassies of a sunken world, but inside reflect a mental comfort which suggests a state of affairs in which one could make oneself understood among people everywhere in the world. Over cold drinks and with a cool head place, all the questions of philosophical and lived practice side by side, and as on a medieval pool, e.g. in the great city of Damascus or in Cordoba, chooses the best. So does a merchant bring his beloved daughter gifts from afar. So do storytellers travel and bear the latest and most interesting news to remote parts of the world. The walls which shelter these two so very different scholars were, it is true, of imperial origin, but for the moment it was a place in which no empires were being founded or were spent. The new imperial arm, this was the diplomat's fear, was more likely emerging in slums 5 miles from where they were sitting. And the no longer young astrophysicist sitting opposite him would be one of the first to be consumed by these greedy jaws of the able. One such popular will pushes in its way out of the able into the tempest. Days before Christmas Eve, the waters of the heathen river Wangachu brought down the middle piers of the railway bridge which carries the Wellington Auckland main line. Initially, heavy rainfalls are said to have been the cause. The inertia of emotions dictates that in New Zealand, even when the landscape displays all the attributes of summer, it is the wish of everyone to go into his own city as soon as Christmas Eve approaches. Consequently, this press train, which plunged into the depths of the point where the bridge had given way, was crowded. The locomotive, 5 carriages. The electric lights worked to the last moment. I saw, reports a witness, the carriages disappear into the torrential river with the windows still lit up. On 6 December 2009, negotiations in Geneva between the Federal Republic of Germany and the People's Republic of China to establish mutual acknowledgement of industrial standards broke down. Among other things, this was because China does not have general rules corresponding to the DIN norms. Consequently, for trade with the People's Republic of China, also for possible diplomatic notes and declarations of war, the relationship of the Federal Republic to this great country remains indeterminate. According to German law, the following applies. December begins with the same day of the week as September. So if 1 September is a Monday, then so is 1 December. If 29, 30 or 31 December is a Monday, the days from Monday of the first calendar week are included with the following year. In accordance with the DIN norm, in this case, the last calendar week of the year ends with the last Sunday of December. If people wish to experience 1 or 2 more weekdays, then they do so outside of time. Organizations, on the other hand, always move forward in 52 intact weeks. Thank you. dance in the living room, guests sitting on the crescent, those sitting on the switch are sinners. The twilight hour comes, candles, we're all together. Yes, we are alive indeed, and even in the best of cheer, sitting out the stars. The father, a soldier, has come home on leave. The mother has been unfaithful. The children know that, they say. Yet, two who love remain true to each other. Their mother starts. Was it an illusion? The children, however, have betrayed nothing, only said the truth.
Local cada vez más tiene menos posibilidades de actuar.
Discrepo con Arcadi, ¿no? Con respecto a que las aventuras de cierto tipismo mediterráneo o del mesoyorno europeo,
esa sobrecarga, pero encima ahora esta de los italianos, hombre, no me parece bien, no me parece bien, la verdad. Insisto, yo no sé llamarle agujero en el funcionamiento de la Unión Europea o qué, también. Pero vamos, no parece, ¿no?
Thank you.
In the month of great uncertainty, in December 1941, Marita, the wife of the surgeon Dauphine, had come to Berlin from her provincial town, was staying at the Grand Hotel of Fürstenberg on Potsdamer Platz, and had refused to request the First Lieutenant Berlepsch to copulate with her. Only 3 weeks later, she regretted the decision. The young officer fell in the fighting in northern Russia. She would have been at last comfort to him, and from that point would have judged the little car he had sent back to her room different. They knew each other from a fancy dress ball in the provincial town in Pisa. She would have stolen away to him. Now it was all too late. He had wanted to save up the promising relationship, not squander it for the sake of a brief moment. She had liked the young officer. The uncertainty, above all the lack of influence on whether and when someone will be struck down by the war, makes the soul old. There is nothing to be lost anymore. So after an air raid in 1944, which went on for hours, Gerda F. did not save herself any longer. Not thought of waiting for one of the returning warriors, whom she still knew and who would ask her hand. She didn't want to get to know any better those left behind in the armament factories of the place. All were looking for closeness. She took a man who was passing through town up to her room. They never saw each other again. There was nothing in about she regretted. For one night full of bliss, I would give my all. Comrade Andropov, his health always fragile, hence loath to move and not keen on travel, was still in charge of the KGB but preparing himself for the position as General Secretary of the party. At the time, there was in one of the main sections of the Soviet secret police of Kyrgyz, Colonel Lermontov, whose ancestors included pagan priests, Siberian animists. In his office hours, in such a vast organization, with a planetary presence immense quantities of time slip by, they flow more slowly than anywhere else in the world outside the windows of the tall concrete building. He put together a collection of historical sketches. A number of these sketches were concerned with paralysis at the decisive moment. It is a curious fact that the great beginnings of world history are often sized by a paralysis and that at decisive moments. It would be doctrinaire to maintain, says Lermontov, that there are no gods. Evidently, they make themselves felt as encouragement or paralysis. Do you, Lermontov, ask listening comrades, seriously want to hold a cold responsible for Napoleon at Waterloo, not fighting the battle of encirclement, which his generals advised that which guarantees certain victory? Do you want to explain the failure by a cold? No, by the Emperor's lack of believing his own mission, replied one of the learned Secret Service assistants, who was educating himself every day. In those years, they were all educating themselves for perestroika, of whose coming they had a premonition, without anyone knowing what name the new freedom would have. I dispute that, returned Lermontov. The god who paralyzes him is the same as the one who struck us a bolt of lightning before Trojans and Greeks. You say that as a materialist. That's exactly what I say, replied Lermontov. A materialist is never doctrinaire. He does not, without reason, exclude the influence of any power in the world as impossible. Above all, not when it opens itself up to observation. Take Hitler's strange policies, his blinding at the very moment of the fiasco at the front outside Moscow. In December 1941, as if snowblind, he declares war on the US. He was not bound by treaty to do so.
Llevan hasta casco, tío, la prensa. Llevan casco.
Poema, cantaban a la Virgen, poema, cantaban a la Virgen, poema, poema, los juncos de la orilla, del quema, los juncos de la orilla, del quema. Tiempo detente, que es tan grande el consuelo que mi alma siente, que duren mis anhelos eternamente.
He seals the end of the Third Reich under a surprise interdictor to Montov superior, who had joined in the group. What exactly are you working on, comrade? Then stealing that Imperium disposed of all the time's reserves of Siberia. As the war reserves of ideas, the strong room of the life of the soul, academic entities of the land gathered in the bunkers of the KJV. I, Gorbachev's lost assistant, was reminded of Lermontov's reflections as I observed the president rise. I struck him after we returned from the conference in Madrid. We went begging him. He was never again the man he had been, a capricious Mediterranean god of these times, who at the side of Athene helped destroy Troy. I got into him as viruses, insect bites, poisons, great disappointments are able to do. So he sat in his room, idle, while the gun of aid hatched a plot, dispossessed their state. Should he have had them arrested for high treason, he had the authority to do so. We buried Colonel Lermontov shortly after the disaster at Chernobyl. Abandoned by all gods, he had shot himself.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah,
blood.
Not amazing. Not amazing.
Fantastic.
Right hand. That one.
Won't work.
No, I don't want to risk it.
It's got to be there.
No.
A what?
2, 3, 4.
5, 6, 7, 8.
No, it's better drop.
Wonderful.
No, you do it. You've got to have a go.
Islamist, said Jamal Islam, anthropophysicist from Bangladesh, familiar with Sufi texts and which since 1150 have only been passed on orally, as God wills, deal with three sorts of time. I look at my watch, I read tempus, this is operating time. It links me to the atomic clocks of the scientific world. In this time measurement, earth and sand move in the context of the Milky Way, So with only 250 million years, they circle the core of the galaxy in sweet harmony. Aeon is to be distinguished from tempus. It is the disembodied time of angels. I turn my inner gaze to the center. Their alas black sun shines from the inside out. The origin of the black light lies to the west of the solar plexus, elliptical, to confuse the sensation between diaphragm and solar plexus, which is felt in states of fear or happy agitation, with the radiation of angels. Only the centrality of millions of believers allows the radiation of Aeon to emerge, on which the souls travel